What actions or deeds are you prepared to make to improve relations between Cuba and the United States?
Robert McNeil had a knack for being where the action was. He covered major stories around the world and titled his 1982 memoir, The Right Place at the Right Time.
I am a wordsmith. That is my trade, is using words, either writing them or speaking them.
He was a lifelong lover of language, literature, and the arts, who called himself in a later memoir, Wordstruck. And he was the visionary and driving force in the creation of the institution that with Jim Lehrer became the NewsHour.
First, tell the story of how all this happened.
In 2000, he described their approach
about,
this way.
Fundamental fairness and objectivity, and also the idea that the American public is smarter than they're often given credit for on television. Yeah. And they don't all need things in little bite-sized, candy-sized McNuggets of news. How could we add a kind of respect for complexity to the news that was already there? And really, that's how our concept was born.
Robert McNeil, known to his friends as Robin, was born in Montreal and raised in Halifax, Nova Scotia. His Canadian roots would remain important to him throughout his life. And he spent part of his summers at a home by the sea. That love of the sea came from his parents. His father, Robert, a lieutenant commander in the Royal Canadian Navy during World War II, and later a Canadian Foreign Service officer. His mother, Margaret, who also instilled in him his love of poetry and language. He set out first to be an actor, but after graduating from Carleton University in Ottawa, turned to journalism. He worked for Reuters and NBC News, first in London, later based in Washington. He covered the assassination of John F. Kennedy in Dallas, even reporting live by phone from inside the Texas School Book Depository, where he may have run into Lee Harvey Oswald.
I heard that this guy called Oswald had been arrested who worked at the book depository, and I said, "Isn't that odd? That's the building I went into. God, he must have been coming out about the time I went in."
For NBC and later the BBC, he would cover a wide range of stories, both abroad and at home.
Dr. King, you're quoted
here in 1963 on Meet the Press, talking with civil rights leaders Martin Luther King Jr. and Roger Wilkins.
In a few moments, we're
Robin's connection to PBS began in 1971 when he was hired to co-anchor NPACT, the National Public Affairs Center for Television. At the time, Public Broadcasting's unit in Washington, responsible for news-related programming.
Butterfield revealed that all of President Nixon's conversations in his two White House offices have been tape-recorded for the past 2 years.
From Washington.
The breakthrough for Robin and the future of news on PBS came with the 1973 gavel-to-gavel primetime coverage of the Senate Watergate hearings.
The committee will come to order.
To the ultimate question. How high did the scandals reach, and was President Nixon himself involved?
It was here that McNeil was first teamed up with Lehrer, Jim Lehrer. The two would also rebroadcast the hearings with analysis late into the night, some 250 hours in all. I spoke with Robin and Jim on the 40th anniversary of the hearings.
And some of these things came out quite unexpectedly. In a very casual, almost offhand manner. Everything is underlined nowadays. Everything is arrows pointing at it. This is going to be a great day today, and we're likely to hear. We didn't have any of that kind of buildup. Mm-hmm. It's just the hearings spoke for themselves.
The success of the coverage and the chemistry of the team led to the creation in 1975 of the Robert McNeil Report, with Jim Lehrer first as its Washington correspondent and soon a full partner in the McNeil-Lehrer report. In 2016, Robin and Jim looked back at their beginnings.
Many people in public television had thought we should be doing sophisticated entertainment and education and culture and not journalism, not public affairs, because that would cause controversy and everything. But our coverage of the Senate Watergate hearings, which clearly were a turning point in this country in all kinds of ways, got more and more people suddenly watching their public television stations and sending money to them. That turned people's heads around in public television, and people began saying, well, you've become a team, you should do a daily show.
The transition to a full hour, the McNeil-Lehrer News Hour, came in 1983. It was a bold move, but very much in step with what Robin and Jim saw themselves doing from the beginning.
And we ended up as an alternative. And given the dozens of channels now that are doing something called news, from the serious to the comic, this is the one that has stayed absolutely gimmick-free. And therefore, its uniqueness is more apparent now, I think, than it was when we started 30 years ago.
The hour-long program became noted for its civil tone and the depth of its coverage.
Who are you afraid of in the region that you need?
Through the years, Robin conducted interviews with numerous world leaders.
I'd like to grope a little further.
Well, grope away.
At home, he explored a wide array of issues of the day.
We lead tonight with a look at teenagers and the AIDS epidemic.
Still to come on the NewsHour, what's ahead in Bosnia and rethinking affirmative action?
And Robin insisted on the importance of including the arts in the NewsHour's reporting. He regularly talked with writers and other artists in this country and abroad. The McNeil Lair team gained honors, viewers, and the attention of cartoonists. A 1981 Doonesbury cartoon had Robin saying, "I'll be asking smooth, urbane questions from New York. Jim Lair will handle the earnest, plain-spoken questions from Washington. Jim?" And the New Yorker poked fun at the way the two were occasionally mixed up by viewers. "I never knew who was who until the other one left."
A lot of people think there's a McLarer out there somewhere, right. But anyway.
"Hello, Mr. McNulty."
That's McNeil.
"Oh, sorry."
The pair also enjoyed being part of the public television family, including the gang on Sesame Street, which Robin visited to interview a certain well-known grouch.
Our cameras are on Sesame Street, where Oscar the Grouch is ready, willing, and crazy to talk to us. "I see that you're in the ice cream business."
"Oh, did you figure that out all by yourself, or did Lara help you?"
Even while co-anchoring the nightly program, Robin took on other projects, especially focused on his passion for language. His 1986 Round the World nine-part series, The Story of English, broadcast on PBS and the BBC, explored the history and development of the language.
"I'm setting out on a journey now to see what's happening to English in the United States."
Later came a sequel on the richness of language in this country, Do You Speak American? He and I talked about it in 2005.
There is nothing more enjoyable than going around the country and just talking to people and listening. I've always been fascinated by how differently people talk and the humor in that and the sense of personality that comes from that and the sense of local identity. So it was really fun.
He was also pursuing his own writing, nonfiction first. But in 1995, he decided to step away from daily journalism to focus on writing fiction and to work on other projects. His first novel, Burden of Desire, followed the impact of the famous World War I explosion in Halifax Harbor on the lives of his fictional characters. Other novels would follow. As Robin made his last appearance in the anchor chair, his longtime partner and close friend had this to say.
"He's leaving permanent tracks along the way he traveled and worked and created. They are tracks of courage to do what he knew to be right, then to actually do it right, and to do it with grace and class and with good humor."
Hey, Robin.
I guess that's it.
Yeah. Hey, good night.
Robin remained involved with the NewsHour. He and Jim headed McNeil Lair Productions, which owned the program until 2014. And in addition to writing, he pursued other projects. Continuing his deep connection to the arts, he served as chairman of the McDowell Artist Colony in New Hampshire for 17 years. He and I spoke there in 2007 during McDowell's centennial celebration.
The real importance of art is that it is the greatest expression of American ideal of freedom. Artists are intellectually and creatively freer than anybody.
And your sense is that that understanding of the role of art as expressing American freedom has been lost, diminished?
I don't know whether it's seen as acutely in the public consciousness. Winston Churchill said, back in the late 40s, The empires of the future are going to be empires of the mind. And so much of what this country, the face that this country presents to the world, is the face that expresses its ideas and its ideals.
Beginning tonight, we look
he
at
he also
where
continued
we stand
to make documentaries, including the 2007 PBS series America at a Crossroads about the war on terror. And a 2011 series for the NewsHour titled Autism Now,
Nick,
a very personal project that included the story of his grandson, Nick. In 1997, Robin became an American citizen and wrote of the love he'd come to feel for his adopted land in the last of his three memoirs, Looking for My Country. He spoke of it in 2003 on C-SPAN.
All the years I was becoming embedded, so to speak, in this country, literally and figuratively. Living through all the traumas of America, both personally with alongside Americans and covering them as a journalist, there was in my being a disconnect between the country I inhabited and the country that inhabited me. I was a man with a nationality, but without a psychic country, so to speak.
He was a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and gained many honors over the years, including, with Jim, induction into the Television Academy Hall of Fame in 1999.
We demonstrated that we could do it in a different and more comprehensive and analytical way, and suddenly the argument had been won over whether there was a role for public broadcasting in this area.
Robert McNeil is remembered by those of us who worked with him with respect, gratitude, and love. He was an extraordinary man who helped guide millions through extraordinary times with his intelligent, passionate, and humane journalism. He had this to say when he signed off from the NewsHour in 1995.
I could be proud of when I went home every night. But that applies equally to our viewers. Without you, no program. There are now some 5 million of you a night, and you express a loyalty to this program of a quality I've never experienced anywhere else. Thank you for understanding what we do. You'll find all the same values there on Monday night and in the years ahead. Thanks, and good night.